So actually, like, before I get started, I'm curious, quick show of hands, how many people are currently or have in the past used Rails at work? Okay, how about Elm? Wow, is that like the same number? That's wild. What an audience. Haskell? And even, wow, okay, cool. How many people are not using one of the two functional technologies but would like to be at work? Okay, cool. So I think this talk will probably be of most use to that audience, but everybody hopefully will have something to get out of it. So I'm Richard Feldman. This is From Rails to Elm and Haskell. So back in 2013, I was evaluating two different potential job opportunities. One of them, I was like, yeah, this company seems really cool. I'd like to work on that product. I'm really excited about what they're building. And the other company, I was like, I'm really excited about their technology. I'd really like to work on that stack. And the stack in particular happened to be, well, the thing that stood out to me was Haskell. I was like, oh, that's really appealing to me. And the reason that it was, you know, at this time, like, I'd never actually used a functional programming language, but I had a friend who enthusiastically recommended learning Haskell. I hear some laughs. Maybe you have a friend like that. Maybe you are that friend. But me having never, you know, used it before, I was just like interested, but not actually a practitioner yet. And so I was like, you know, I know this is like a purely functional programming language, and honestly, I didn't know that much about it. I ended up reading like some chapters of Learn You a Haskell and stuff, but really didn't know a whole ton about it. But I did know myself, and I did know that like the way that I tend to learn tools best is like by actually building applications with them. Anybody else like that? Like, that's how you like to learn? Yeah, cool. I think that's pretty common. So this company was advertising that they were, you know, hiring Haskell developers, and I was like, cool. So I heard you're using Haskell there. This is a really small startup, so I was actually interviewing like directly with the CTO. He was like, yeah, so I wanted to originally, but I also wanted to be able to hire people, so I went with Scala. And I was like, oh. Well, you're not going to be hiring this guy, because that was the whole reason I was interested in your company in the first place. So I did not end up working there. I was instead just like, okay, well, I guess I'm going to keep looking. So I went back to the other company, which is the company whose product I was excited about, NoRedInk, where 6 years later I'm still working. And the thing that I was excited about is basically like they help teachers teach writing. I'm really into writing, and that was like a passion of mine. Even though there really wasn't anything about the tech stack that appealed to me, I was like, cool, you know, there's more to life than just the tech stack. I have to remind myself of that sometimes. And I was like, I'm gonna get on board. So back then, it was like really, really small company. There were just, it was like Jeff, the founder, Michael, Josh, and like 1.5x of me. And basically, you know, there was like one more guy remote represented by this laptop. That was the whole company. Essentially, we were, you know, getting off the ground, really small company. And really, when you're a small company, you have kind of a weird relationship with risk. On the one hand, it's like, well, if you want to try something kind of new and out there, it's like, well, you don't have a whole lot of people you got to convince. But on the other hand, it's sort of like, well, but anything could tank the company. Who knows? In this case, I'm not actually speaking about either of those technologies. These days we're like 80 some odd people, so it's a totally different scenario. But back then, it was actually a different technology that we were evaluating. So at the time when I joined the company, this was our stack. It was Rails and CoffeeScript. Anyone ever done CoffeeScript? Okay, yeah, like probably around this time period, maybe a few years before, hasn't really stood the test of time the way that some of these others have. That was very normal back in 2013. What was abnormal was what I was doing. I was the front end team. So what I was doing with my CoffeeScript was basically I'd read a couple chapters of Learn You a Haskell, and I kind of knew the rules, like, you know, don't mutate stuff, don't put side effects in your functions. So basically I was doing a functional style CoffeeScript. By which I mean just like pretend it's Haskell and just like enforce the rules in my head, kind of. This is not necessarily quite the same thing, but on the front end, that was kind of like what I was working with at the time. Then React comes out in 2013. Like, you know, they open source it from Facebook. And I was like, I don't know anything about this technology. And I read some blog post or something, and it was like, so in React, UI is a pure function from state to, I'm like, I'm very interested in this all of a sudden. Didn't really keep reading the rest of the docs before I was like, yes, I want to get my hands on this and try it. And I really liked it. But at the same time, it was sort of controversial. So Pete Hunt went on this like speaking tour giving this talk. This is in like JSConf EU 2013 called Rethinking Best Practices. And it was based on this tweet from a popular JavaScript library author who was like, Facebook, rethink established best practices. Like, oh, look at you doing this weird stuff with React. That'll never catch on. But you know, that's what a lot of people say about functional programming stuff. It's like, oh, you're doing all this weird, not object-oriented stuff. Like, what are you thinking? It's like, well, I don't know. Maybe sometimes people have good reasons for going against the grain. But that's where we were at the time. So like back then, it's like, okay, we're this five-person company. Do we want to take a chance on this thing? Is that like where we want to spend our risk budget, is like on this new weird front-end technology? We don't really know if it's going to pan out for us. So we kind of evaluated it. We were like, okay, let's just like look at the risks, look at the potential rewards, and see what we think. So some of the risks, like no ecosystem, like we're giving up on the entire jQuery ecosystem at this point to move into this React thing, which is, you know, it's a big risk. Everybody talks about ecosystem being one of the downsides of sort of smaller tools. Learning curve, right? Everybody's going to have to learn this whole new thing called React when they're, you know, what's a virtual DOM? How do we hire people, right? What if people don't want to use React? Like, there's a really small community. You can put up a job posting for jQuery. There's a billion people who know jQuery. But, you know, this is a real question for us. But we did think there were some potential rewards. So fewer rendering bugs. That was, like, kind of a consistent theme, right? Like, it's, like, more functional style. Things are more straightforward, easier to debug, more reliable system. More maintainable code, because we don't have to deal with mutation as much. This is something I'd already kind of bought into, like, early on, the idea, like, less dealing with mutable state, fewer bugs, more easy to maintain, sounds good. And also just growing as developers. I think this is a pretty underrated reason to make technical choices. Like, if you want to hire good people tend not to be like, yeah, you know, Fortran's good enough for me forever. I'm just going to stick with exactly what I know, and then I'm never going to learn any new things. Like, oh, actually, like, people want to grow, and if you're not using technologies that let them grow, they're going to leave and go to a place where they can do that. So if you want to retain really good people, sooner or later, you got to push the envelope technically. I think that just sort of is axiomatic. So ultimately, what we decided to do is we're just going to do a controlled experiment. We're like, we're just going to try out React and just see if the rewards materialize. So basically, this is our recipe. Like, find a low-risk project that's a good fit for the technology. Get it all the way into production. So we find out about all the like weird deployment stuff and getting it integrated into our CI and our build process and all that. And then basically from there, either, if it goes well, expand incrementally, just keep doing that a little bit more, or if we don't end up liking the technology, we can back out and we haven't really sacrificed much because we picked a low-risk project. So in our case, this was the student dashboard, and basically we had this sort of need for a live update. Basically the use case is we have like a teacher who's in a computer lab, and they want to press a start assignment button so all the kids get the assignment at the same time. We don't want to have the teacher have to ask the kids, okay, now everybody hammer on the refresh button until it shows up. We want them to just hit the start button, and then on the kid's screen, you know, just immediately live updates. So this is actually a pretty good fit for React, because basically it meant that if we designed this one part of the page using React, where we could just have this pure function from the state to the UI that was supposed to display there, all we had to do was take care of polling to update the state, and then we just were done. We didn't have to rewrite any, like, oh, we'll delete this node and replace it with this node. It was like, no, it'll just work. So it was a good fit, but it was also like a pretty low risk thing, because this was the entirety of the part of the page that we were doing in React. It was just this one section here. So that meant that it was not only a good fit for the technology, but it was also sort of a low risk experiment we could do to get our better understanding. The next question we had was, okay, we've identified a good project, like how are we actually going to learn this? It's going to be something that like the team has to learn. So one resource, of course, the official documentation, that's sort of a standard theme here. Talks and blog posts, there were like a few of those at this point in 2013. And of course, the to-do MVC code base, so like just a substantial enough example project that we can kind of, you know, look at it and sort of figure out how that might translate to our code. So 2013, we got React into production. And ultimately, the experiment was a success. Like, yeah, this worked. Great. Let's start incrementally expanding it. So at this point, it's like, all right, I'm already writing Haskell-style CoffeeScript, and now I get to do it with React stapled on top. Does life get any better than this? I mean, really, like, I'm living the dream. Like, it's really, could there be possibly a more elegant way to do front-end programming than this? As it turned out, there was. So in 2014, I found out about this language called Elm. Because Elm got a virtual DOM, which is the thing that React has, like this way of declaratively specifying your UI as a pure function from current state to how the UI ought to look. And the thing that caught my eye was actually a blog post about Elm's performance. So Elm had been benchmarked against this new like rendering system against a whole bunch of the popular ones of the day, and it was actually like doing really well in the benchmarks. But for me, I looked at this thing and I was like, oh wait, this is like a actual pure functional language like Haskell. Like it's actually all immutable values. It's not just me pretending CoffeeScript has only immutable values. It actually doesn't have side effects or null. It actually has like a real Hamley-Milner type checker instead of nothing. All of these were were really appealing to me over here in, you know, fake Haskell pretending CoffeeScript sit land. So this was really exciting to me, and so I started using it on a side project of mine called Dreamwriter, which is this like piece of novel writing software that I've been building. This is me at a meetup talking about it back in, I think, 2014 something. Basically, I just decided to port my like React code base to Elm and just to learn the language, because that's how I like to learn, by building things. And I loved it. I was just absolutely head over heels in love with this language and just having so much fun with it. But I didn't really think that this is like something I would use at work, because I was like, well, we're a small startup. We don't have the risk budget to, I mean, we just took this big risk on React. Surely we're not gonna take a risk on this like functional programming language. I thought this right up until we started doing a sequence of classroom observations. So a classroom observation, has anyone ever here done a user study? Anything like that? Okay, so for those who haven't, the basic idea is you take your program out and like watch real users use it, and then generally sort of like watch your jaw drop in horror as you see how they're actually using your software. And imagine that, but with middle schoolers. So this really puts your code through the ringer. And so we had a thing where we were teaching active voice versus passive voice, which is like a hard concept for adults to learn, let alone middle schoolers. And it was really just like every design we threw, we would like take it out and use it like, they are not getting this. They're totally lost. Like, we got to go back to the drawing board and just revamp this whole design on the whiteboard and then re-implement it. And every time we did this, we would have to go through our React code base, and like all the tests would break because it was such a big change to the design. And they'd be like, okay, like redo all the stuff. And it would just take like weeks to get it back to a state where we could take it out and watch it fail on a different classroom observation and learn more. And the iteration cycle was really long on this. And I kept thinking, man, I refactor my Elm project just for fun. Like, I just make huge changes and then I just watch the compiler errors until they're all gone, and then it works again magically. And by the end of this, I was like, you know, if we'd adopted Elm before we went out and did this, like, it would have paid for itself just on this one feature. Like, not even, you know, like years down the line. It's like just on this one thing, even after you count the amount of time it would take to ramp up the team. So I kind of felt like I was just too risk averse. Like, I was too afraid to try and adopt this thing that I already knew was really good based on my side project. So I was like, okay, let's do this. Like, let's do the same analysis we did with React and just like risk reward, see if it makes sense for our company. So the risks. Number one, smaller ecosystem. Well, that was the same risk we had with React and really hadn't been a big problem in practice. There was also a learning curve. Okay, granted, this is a bigger learning curve. I mean, React was a library. This is a whole programming language, definitely a step up in terms of learning curve. So a bigger risk than it was with React. And then, of course, how we hire people. I think that's also magnified in terms of, you know, what type of a thing are we dealing with here. If we don't hire React developers, it's like, well, maybe somebody's kind of curious to learn it. How many people are actually curious to learn Elm? We didn't really know. But the rewards also seem kind of magnified. Like, being able to actually move fast without breaking things, that sounded pretty exciting. we knew how to break things, but I mean, kind of had enough of that at this point. Also just having, in general, a more reliable front end, not just from like the, you know, some design of things being different, but actually from like, there is a compiler that will tell you when you break a whole class of problems. That was a pretty serious amount of reliability increase. And also, as far as growing as developers go, again, like learning a new library, okay, like that's some personal growth for sure. That's like, you know, honing your craft. But like learning a language and a different paradigm, that's a pretty big jump. That's like pretty appealing in a way that learning a library is not. So all of the rewards seem kind of magnified too. So definitely higher risk, but also potentially higher reward. We decided to bite the bullet and do it. We basically used exactly the same recipe as before. Just low risk project that's a good fit. Get it all the way into production, and then from there, either expand incrementally, or if it doesn't work, then back it out. So in this case, we ended up using a drag and drop interface, which had some pretty complicated business logic around like whether or not you can pick something up or where you can drop it. So actually, what we ended up deciding was like, you know what, this is a pretty good fit for Elm because there's a lot of complexity there. And at the end of the day, it's also low risk because there's not any rendering involved. It's just business logic, and it's just on this one page. So it seemed like a pretty good fit. Help us tame this complexity. At the end of the day, if we didn't end up liking it, we weren't even touching our render code, so we could just throw it all out and replace it with JavaScript if the experiment failed. As far as learning resources, this was again the next thing to consider. So the official Elm guide, which is very well written, and if you're learning Elm, I highly recommend reading that, even though I've got a book that I'm writing and almost done about learning Elm. good old dependable to-do MVC code base, a nice example to draw on. And actually, in this case, we had the DreamWriter code base that I'd been doing in my spare time, which was useful not just because it was a bigger, more fleshed out example of how to build an application in Elm, but also because I was really familiar with it, and I could use that and the knowledge that I'd gained to sort of help my teammates learn. So this is going back to the previous talk about the idea of teammates helping teammates and being able to like have an expert on the team is a really useful thing if you can swing it. So this was definitely an instrumental tool in our like ability to learn Elm, which to be fair, we kind of needed because this was a step up from a library. This is a whole language, so having more resources was important. So 2015, we got Elm into production. One of the things that turned out to be a nice benefit shortly after we got it into production, because this was not true right when we launched, was the error friendliness. So I came from a Java background, and I'm used to these type of things. Being the level of error friendliness that I get when something goes wrong. It's like big long stack trace that says org.apache.jasper, I think 18,000 times in there, which is really helpful. Sometimes there's even more ridiculous pathological stack traces you can get out of all the layers and layers of frameworks. So then to have that and then to come with like Elm, which is like, okay, hey, the user record does not have a phone number field. It's like got the little red underline. This is usually a typo. Here are the user fields that are most similar. Let me just bottom line it for you. Maybe phone number should be phone number. Like, this is just a whole different planet of user friendliness. Like, wow, thank you. You're right. And now I just feel loved. I'm really appreciative of like this user experience. So this is like an unexpected benefit. It wasn't even on our radar for rewards, but it turned out to be really nice, and now it's something that people like most about the language. Another thing was runtime exceptions. So Elm's got this like tagline of no runtime exceptions, which is like not literally, it's impossible. Like, yeah, you can get a Stack Overflow and stuff, but like in practice, people don't really see it. So this is a chart of our runtime exceptions that we've gotten since 2015. So we have this like little tool that runs, and every time there's a runtime exception, it records it. Now, it's not actually zero, but it is 0 pixels. So that's about 60,000 on the JavaScript side, and the Elm one doesn't actually register on the slide. It has happened, but so few times that it doesn't make 1 pixel on the graph. So it's like not actually zero, okay, but like this is really not something we spend any time thinking about anymore, which is nice because it was something we used to have to spend a ton of time thinking about and dealing with. And now it's just like, oh, well, we just run our code and it works. It's pretty nice. And as a consequence of these things, like the error friendliness and lack of runtime exceptions, stuff like that, people are just happier. I know it's a shock considering where we came from, but actually people are happier using Elm than like Haskell-flavored CoffeeScript with React stapled on top. It's a more coherent experience, and like if you want to work in the functional paradigm, I know there's like a lot of sort of, I don't know, popularity is maybe the right term, but it's a trend that I've seen to say, hey, I'm going to do functional style JavaScript or Scala, but like only using the functional features and none of the OO features, things like that. I highly recommend using something that just fully embraces functional. It's like really a much more coherent experience if you can, swing it. This is one example of this. Katie Hughes, one of our developers, said, it's been weird transitioning to a language/framework that I can just trust. I don't really need to move to the browser and see if everything secretly broke, like flipping back and forth and refreshing the page like we used to. So she came from a React background, and like this kind of echoes my own feelings, like just that feeling of trust and like, oh, it compiled, like it's probably going to work again. So I actually gave a talk based on, this is like a stolen title. It's called Make the Backend Team Jealous, Elm in Production. This is because one of my coworkers who was working on the Rails part of the code base was actually, like he said, I actually feel jealous of people who are working on the front end because y'all are really excited and happy about Elm, and like I'm over here in Railsland. And keep in mind, like Ruby is a beloved language. But he's like, yeah, I just like really wish we had something like that, but we don't. Which got us thinking, and we'll come back to that. this is a big surprise. Hiring got easier when we adopted Elm. So actually, like to date, Elm has been the number one reason that people apply since 2015. Like it's like far and away like the main reason that people want to come work here. When we hired a head of talent, she commented, "I have never seen an inbound pipeline this strong." Like this is a recruiter saying, "Like how did you do this? People just like apply to your jobs. You don't have to reach out and bombard them with emails like to try and get someone to come work for your React job." It's like, well, yeah, it turns out there's like an imbalance here, right? There's a lot more people interested in using Elm than there are companies hiring for Elm. Now, maybe someday that imbalance will shift, and I think the same is probably true of Haskell as well. But for now, it's just like, yeah, people are like, I want to use this new technology. I want to grow. This sounds really interesting to me. but there aren't that many companies hiring for it. So if you're one of those few companies that is hiring for it, just yes, please. Thank you for all the resumes and like of really good people. Worth noting though that like there is kind of a supply limitation. So we hire for remote positions, and so this has worked out really well for us. I can't guarantee that you would see the same results if you're like only hiring within your local geographic area. There just may not be physically that many people who are interested in the technology and looking. But at least for us, it's been, I literally do not remember how we hired anyone before Elm, because it's made that big of a difference for us. So was the experiment a success? Yes. It was, in fact, such a big success that we actually ended up hiring the creator about a year later. And basically, like he's been working here ever since. So we've been pretty much directly financially contributing to open source by paying him exclusively to work on the language for about 3 years now, 3.5. That's also just been like kind of a cool thing to like work at a company that's like, yeah, we actually pay for our open source stuff that's been really valuable to us. And not just any open source stuff, but actually a pure functional programming language. So glad to be a part of that. And again, like the way that we got there was basically following the same recipe as we did with React. Find a low-risk project, get it into production, and then expand incrementally. So what that incremental expansion looked like was back in 2013, we introduced a little bit of React. In 2014, we kind of started growing it. 2015, we didn't stop using React. We just introduced a little bit of Elm. And then that sort of like grew and grew and grew. And then over time, now we're at the point where basically like almost our entire front end is Elm. There's like a tiny bit of legacy React back in the day. It's funny, like when I used to talk to people in 2016 about this, I was like, we have like legacy React code. And they're like, we're adopting React. I'm like, yeah, well, you know, this is an option too, right? This is a viable path. I don't want to give you the impression that all of our experiments have been a resounding success. We've definitely had mixed success with some of these. Like, here are some other technologies that we tried, and like, ultimately, we liked some things about them, but not enough to sort of commit to them and say, like, this is what we're going to be doing the way that we have with Elm. All of these, like, we tried them out, we used them to varying degrees, and ultimately, we were just like, you know what? We're just not going to expand our use of them further, or in some cases, we're like, we're going to back it out. This is the benefit of doing this experimentation style. It means that if you try something new and you don't like it, it was a low-risk investment, and it's okay if you back it out. It's not going to hurt anything, or not going to hurt a lot of stuff. This did ultimately lead us to this question of, like, hey, what do we want our back-end stack to look like in, like, 5 years? We've determined that the back-end team is jealous of the front-end team, but, like, okay, if it's not going to be Rails, what is it going to be? So we kind of took a step back and just said, like, what has worked well for us historically? What's worked best? So declarative over imperative was kind of a theme, like React, Elm, SQL. All of these were moving in an increasingly declarative direction. Specifically, we really like type pure functional programming. Like, that's been really a home run for us, and everybody's really happy with it. And also, we like these ideas of build time schema checks, like making connections between two different parts of the system throw errors at build time rather than at runtime if something's off between them. This is one of the things that we liked about GraphQL, is like this Elm GraphQL library that's really nice about checking the schema at build time rather than finding out about problems at runtime with the decoding failures. So any language was fair game. I mean, we really put absolutely everything on the table. We talked about all these languages and then some, and we're like, yeah, but like, what do we want? And at the end of the day, if you want a like typed pure functional language that has an ecosystem, it pretty much narrows it down to one language. There are others like PureScript and Idris that we talked about, but at the end of the day, it's like, if you want both strongly typed pure functional and a sizable ecosystem, like both of them don't really have much on the back end as far as like a at least enough of an ecosystem that we felt like we wouldn't have to be doing stuff like writing our own Postgres drivers. Another nice thing about it is that it actually did have those like build time schema checks for the database like out the box. This type PostgreSQL package that I'll talk a little bit more about later was like a really big selling point for us. Okay, so we did the same analysis we did with the other two, risks and rewards. So smaller ecosystem, well, we've been down that road before. Really hasn't been a problem so far. It's like as long as there's a critical mass of stuff, so we're not having to implement like really, really low level stuff. It's like, yeah, you know, maybe we don't have everything off the shelf. Like we had to write our own error reporting library for Rollbar, but it's like, it's a couple of HTTP calls. Like we can do that, it's not a big deal. Learning curve, again, this is definitely a step up. Like Elm is a programming language, whereas React is a library. Haskell is a programming language, which as the previous talk discussed, like it is known for having a really high learning curve for you know brand new beginners. If you take a room full of Rails developers who know Ruby, and you're like, cool, now we're gonna learn Monad transformers. It's like, wait, hang on. there's some intermediate steps. So definitely this was good. This was a risk. It was like the size of a learning curve. And then, of course, this question, like, how will we hire people? Now, based on our experience with Elm, we're like, okay, this might be a trick. Like, it might actually be the type of thing that is actually a boost to hiring. I can't say that we've, like, done enough yet because we're not really, like, far enough along with our, like, Haskell stuff the way we are with Elm to say, like, we're a Haskell shop now. Come here and you will write Haskell all day, every day. It's more like, we have Haskell projects now. So it's like, a little too early to tell, because since we haven't even been advertising that we're, like, hiring for Haskell programmers, at least not with that, like, job description. But so far, we're, like, you know, based on our Elm experience and knowing how many people, like, all the people in this room who are excited about Haskell and, like, want to go work at a Haskell shop, we're expecting that to be, like, more of a benefit than a cost. Rewards, like potential upsides, definitely, again, like Elm, easier to maintain complex business logic. We have a lot of complex front ends. We have a lot of complexity on the back end, and that's been a big pain point for us, is, like, we have these big tangled blobs of, like, monolithic Rails code, and now that we're like, oh, we want to untangle these so we can split them out into a separate service, or we want to untangle these so that we can refactor them to solve some performance problems, it's really, really hard without having, like, everything separated into pure functions and a type checker that's helping you out with that. So this is one of the big selling points that we're looking for. Also, just a more reliable backend, like one that does not crash as often. Believe it or not, Ruby code also crashes from time to time. Those of you who have used Rails maybe are familiar. But yeah, this again, like the fact that Elm code doesn't tend to crash, Haskell code also likewise, you know, Haskell's not quite as hardcore about it as Elm, but like still, really, if it type checks, like you're really not expecting much in the way of crashes. And again, growing as developers, right? Like this is another thing, even for people who already know Elm, Haskell is a way to grow. There are like many more language features in Haskell than there are in Elm. And although that can be a double-edged sword, one way in which it's definitely a benefit is people are like, yeah, this is a way to expand my brain and learn more. So did our controlled experiment. I know some people are like trying to take a picture of this slide. Well, here it is again. That's the same formula, really. I mean, like anytime we're trying out something new, this is how we've done it. Find a low-risk project, get it into production, and then either expand incrementally or if it doesn't work, back it out. So in this case, we went with sort of an internal service, something that was basically like, we could do it in a kind of greenfield way, but basically it was like a retrofit of some older thing that we'd started up but ultimately abandoned. A nice thing about doing an internal service, if you don't have a microservices architecture, like the previous speakers did, that it means that your customers are sort of understanding if you have some bumps in the road getting it off the ground. It's like, oh, well, you know, you work here too, so just hang on, we'll fix it. As opposed to deploying it like straight into production for like end users. So learning resources, I don't know if anybody else has had a different experience, but maybe you can come talk to me if you had. But my experience was that basically your options are books that are like theory first and then practice, or tutorials that are that way. Another flavor of Haskell learning resources is lambda calculus, then theory, then practice. And then theory, category theory. if you're like me and you want to learn stuff by like building applications, good luck. And to me, this seems like a massive opportunity. If you're really looking for like, hey, I want to learn Haskell by building stuff and then later on learning the theory about what I just built, I don't think that exists. Or if it does, I have not been able to find it. And I've asked quite a few people about this, and so far nobody knows about it. Maybe you're the person who could write this, and I bet you there would be people who'd be interested in it. So, fortunately though, we actually did have quite a few people who knew Haskell on the team, as opposed to before when it was like just me knowing Elm. So we were able to more effectively help each other out about this. So 2017, we got Haskell all the way into production. One thing we did learn is Haskell's kind of the opposite of omakase. So this is a Rails term that basically means like, you go to a sushi restaurant and you're like, I would like omakase, which means the chef will like choose the menu for you and be like, here are your things. Eat them, they'll be delicious. Rails makes all the decisions for you. In contrast with Haskell, first thing is like, which language features do you want? Like, what do strings mean? That's an early decision you have to make, and then you choose your standard library. The one thing that everyone agrees on is obviously don't choose the one that it ships with. That's like, no, just like stock prelude, come on. And then you do normal stuff like choosing a server framework. People ask me like, hey, what choices did you make? And we'll get to those in a second. Michael Newton commented, as a language, I've really enjoyed it being Haskell. There are a lot of knobs to twiddle, no kidding, so it felt important that we'd done the R&D project first. Here's an example of some of the settings that we have. One thing worth noting, I bet there are people in the audience who are like, you're missing a couple, or you shouldn't have some of those ones on that list. So imagine debating on your team like which language features the language should have. It's like, I don't know, what should strings mean? You tell me, you're the language. Another thing to notice is that one at the top, no implicit prelude, that's because instead of using the standard prelude, we were at first using Protolude and now have upgraded to rolling our own, on top of which we're using Scotty, by which I mean we're actually using Servant now. So, you know, all these things, like usually you're dealing with like just the very bottom right corner of this, but in Haskell there's like kind of a lot more upfront investment just to get to a basic starting point, or at least there was for us. In contrast with Elm, it was like, I don't know, we just use all the default stuff and it worked great. So, you know, this is not something we tend to talk about in terms of like language theory and stuff, but it kind of does matter. Like, how much work do you have to do before you can actually like start building your application? Tessa Kelly commented, like, something we did well with Elm that we haven't done with Haskell yet is like identifying a challenging area and then make it less challenging. Like, figure out what are the things that are making this hard to learn or hard to get into and just like make it better. That's an example of like why we ended up going with our own prelude. Error messages, not quite as nice in Haskell. Chris Jenkins had a pretty good tweet about this, like how beginners see Haskell error messages, like, line 67, integer, and like, words I don't know, which is maybe a valid criticism. But ultimately, it's like something people can, you know, get used to over time. Michael Glass made a good comment about this. So he's like, okay, yeah, people do get stuck more than in Elm, but also people don't cause regressions. Like, if you get that error message, that means you're getting it at build time at your desk instead of, like, there's a production fire going off and someone's pager's going off. The guarantees we have from Haskell are really nice. This is one example of that. This is the typed PostgreSQL library. So basically, this is, like, actually writing SQL in line, which I really like because if you're trying to make stuff high performance, you end up writing raw SQL anyway, even if you've got an ORM, at least with every ORM I've ever used. But this stuff right here, like, these are type checked, like, these variables. Not only are they being injected, not using string interpolation, but using like proper binding and everything. But also like they're type checked against both your Haskell code, like what is the type of this variable in my Haskell code, and also against the current type of that value in the database column. So I find out if there's any problem with any of these things at build time. This is really, really nice. I don't know of any other systems that have this like with raw SQL and with that level of checking outside of Haskell. As Giuliano put it, the PostgreSQL type library is my dream come true for an ORM-like thing. And Giuliano has like 8 years of C-sharp background, so like that's another system where people are like, oh yeah, C-sharp has like really good ORMs, not as good as Haskell, at least with this PostgreSQL type package. Okay, so 2017 Haskell experiment result, yeah, total success, and we've been continuing to build it out and use more of it. We've had a few more recent experiments, some of which worked, some of which didn't. Nix has been awesome. We've just started getting into Kubernetes. PostgreSQL we thought was going to be awesome, didn't end up working out. But yeah, I mean, this same method, we've been continuing to use it, and it's been continuing to work great for us. So I highly recommend if you're looking to adopt new technologies, try following this recipe. In conclusion, so back in 2013, I was like, yeah, you know, I'd like to work on that product at NoRedInk versus I'd like to work on that stack with Haskell. Now in 2019, I'm like, hey, cool. I get both. I'm happy working on the product, and I'm happy working on that stack because the company evolved towards the stack that I was excited to use in the first place 6 years ago. And if you're in a similar boat at your company, please consider following this method, and maybe it'll work out for you too. Thanks very much.